So it's really our great pleasure to have Professor Nicola Casabu to give us a talk about to introduce his research. Professor Nicola has a very long bell and he's really well known in the world, in the AI world, and especially in neural network. And some of his early work involve fuzzy system and many other applications as well. Briefly introduce about Professor Casabu. He's a fellow of IEEE, and also he's a fellow of the Royal Society of New Zealand, which is actually more or less the same, works as functions similar like the United States of National Academic Science and Engineering. And he's also a fellow of INS and the College of Fellows, distinguished visiting fellow of the Royal Academic of UK, of Engineering UK. He's also a professor, he's currently a professor in Auckland University of Technology in New Zealand, and also the George Moore Chair Professor of Data Analytics at the University of Ulster in UK. Professor Casabu was the past president of International Society of Neural Network and the Asia Pacific Neural Network Society. And he also a member of several technical committees like IEEE Computational Intelligence Society, distinguished lecturer of IEEE, and he is also editor in chief of many other books like and journals like Neuroinformatics, Springer Series of Bio and the Neural System, and Springer Journal of Evolving System, and serving as an associate editors for many other journals, including Neural Network, IEEE, TRNN, those kind of very top journals. And Dr. Casabu received his PhD from Technical University of Sofia and in Bulgaria, and his main research is currently in neural network, intelligent imaging, intelligent information system, soft computing, bioinformatics, neuroinformatics, and he has published almost 700 papers in my recent check. He has extensive experience in various academic and research organizations in Europe and Asia, Sofia, Bulgaria, and the University of Essex, and the University of Otago in New Zealand, and advisory professor in Shanghai Jiaozhong University, and CISA Beijing, which is the academic science, National Academic of Science in China. He was also a visiting professor in ETH Zurich and the University of Zurich, and he has won quite a lot of awards and like honorary doctor from Obada University in Budapest, and INS Ada Lovelace Memorial Service Award, Neural Network Best Paper, APC, Asian Pacific Neural Network Society Outstanding Achievement Award, INS Gabor Award for Outstanding Contributions in Engineering and Neural Network, EU Marie Curie Fellowship, and the Bear Science Innovation Award, APANA Excellent Service Award, and the Royal Society of New Zealand Science and Technology Medal, and the AUT Auckland University of Technology Medal, an honorary member of Bulgaria and Greek Scottish Societies of Computer Science. He has supervised more than 50 PhD students, and you can check his bell on his website. And also I know Dr. Nicola Casabu about 10 years ago when I conducted academic visiting in his lab, and he was a supervisor at that time. He was my supervisor at that time. It's really my great pleasure to reconnect with him during this talk. Thank you very much, Dr. Casabu, to give us a talk. And I think you can go ahead, your stage.
Thank you very much, Greer. What I consider is a very generous introduction to my work and to myself. I'm happy to give the first for my career, first seminar at the Rochester Institute of Technology, and it's always exciting to do something new. I will talk about the third generation of neural networks, which are the spiky neural networks, considered to be the spiky neural networks. especially how they can fit into the concept of deep learning, and more specifically, spatial or spectro-temporal data, how they can be used to develop novel methods, more efficient methods for spatial spectro-temporal data. First, I will talk about the inspiration from the brain, as spiky neural networks are very much inspired by some functioning of the human brain. I will give a little introduction to the principles of spiky neural networks for people who are not familiar with that, and some more specific architectures called brain-inspired architectures, with some emphasis on how you design your spiky neural network system and a spiky neural network application using these techniques. And I will show examples of applications in neuroimaging, in multisensory data analysis, in human-computer interaction and brain-computer interactions. And most of this material is also included in a recent book, which is called Time, Space, Spiky Neural Networks and Brain-Inspired Artificial Intelligence. Now, why neurocomputation? Well, we are always looking for some data analysis, multi-model data analysis, images and videos and numbers and whatever you have relevant for a problem that you want to solve. And we are always looking for some new methods to model this data. And we always say that from data to information and knowledge. And the complexity of the data increases dramatically with more emphasis on temporal data, spatial temporal, spectro-temporal data. Do we have enough methods to deal with that? Or we need to create new methods? And one approach is the so-called neural networks. Neural networks have been here since probably 1943, by Collett and Pitts and Rosenblatt here, with the invention of the perceptron. And then a lot of people contributed to neural networks. And neural networks are mainly computational models that are based on neurons connected to connection with connections. And these connections are changed, their weights of the connections is changed to associate better inputs to outputs and to reduce this error of association. And these neural networks are early neural networks, have been a lot developed, but they are still considered the early neural networks to be brainpouches. And once trained, it was difficult to adapt to new data without much forgetting. And the evolution of neural networks led to the so-called deep convolutional neural networks. And this is perhaps the first one developed by Fukushima in 1975. Here is Kunihiko Fukushima from Osaka. He gave a talk at the WCCI 2020 last year. So this structure is inspired by the visual cortex. In humans, we have the input layer contrast and neurons that respond to contrast, and we have neurons responding to edge. And this is a deep neural network that learns over time to recognize a certain object. And this concept of deep neural networks was developed recently, and there is a boom in these deep neural networks and convolutional neural networks. And convolutional neural networks means that there is a neuron associated with a certain sub-area of the image or the data using some convolutional function. And deep neural networks indeed are many, many layers that are trained one after another to recognize a certain object or to complete a certain task. Deep neural networks has developed so far are wonderful techniques. They are excellent for vector-based, frame-based data, for example, for image recognition, but not especially for spatial spectro-temporal data, not for knowledge extraction. It's difficult to understand what this deep neural network that has many, many, many layers and thousands of neurons, what does it represent as a piece of knowledge? And usually these deep neural networks have fixed structures and are not readily adaptive to new data through incremental and transfer learning. What do we do Well, let me say that talking about spatial spectrotemporal data, where do we get a better inspiration than from the brain? Because the brain is a deep learning and deep knowledge representation system. It's the most sophisticated of product of the evolution. And it has billions of neurons, trillions of connections, and they do coordinated tasks, coordinated in terms of memory types, and coordinated in terms of temporal activities. For example, the brain has activities at different time scales, like nanoseconds, milliseconds, minutes, hours, many years of evolution. What would be the best inspiration for building multimodal, multi-scale, spatial-temporal data machine than the human brain? And the human brain has evolved different areas, spatially located areas, to respond to different functions. For example, this is the visual cortex, and that is the parietal and the motor cortex, motor area. And they are evolved through learning in time. And we can download the patterns or the template of a brain as a standard template from several sources. For example, one is the Talera template that gives you exactly the areas of the brain and its function as well. And the brain learns in space and in time. For example, if we look how the brain learns when a person is looking at an object, I'm looking at this cup, picking up the understanding what the object is to visual cortex, through parietal frontal lap, prefrontal cortex, and then picking up the cup, activating the motor cortex. It's a spatial-temporal activity of the brain. It's a trajectory that is learned through many experiences. And it is not structured as fixed number of layers, fixed number of connections. No, it evolves its knowledge from data. Well, this is an ultimate inspiration for us. How can we bring these principles to machines, to computers, to develop systems that learn in a similar way, in a deep way, and in an unstructured way? Well, this is only on the surface, but down there, at the neuronal level, there are quite a lot of activities that the neurons, they actually emit electrical potentials. We call them spikes. And we can have abstract representation of spikes, but spikes are generated activities over time. And they involve a lot of molecular activities, a lot of ion channels, like sodium, and other ion channels. And the neurons are excited. They have excitation inputs, and they have also inhibitory inputs to the neuron. That's a balance in the neuron where to spike or not to spike. And based on these very simple principles of spiking information representation in the brain, well, let's look at the engineering aspect of how we can use this principle of spikes over time to build some machines. And I will start with fundamentals of spiking neural networks to probably spend 5 minutes before I move to some spiking neural network architectures. Spikes we can consider over time, either in the so-called rate-based rate representation, which is actually the frequency of spikes. All these spikes are turned into a scalar, that is the frequency. Or we can consider spikes in a temporal way. Every spike at any time, the time matters. It could be millisecond that these spikes over time, and this is time. And here we have spike. And the time they spike matters for many activities like cortical activities like moving and especially in robotics applications. Now, how does the brain encode input information, which is a continuous information like temperature, like the pixels, like sound? How do we encode it into spikes? So the brain can process these spikes further. And we can see that there are different ways to encode information into spikes. One way is inspired by the retina. If there is a pixel increase intensity, there is a spike generated. Decreasing intensity, there is a negative spike or no spike. And this is a retina inspired method used in the so-called dynamic vision sensor, that is an electronic the implementation of this principle. Or we can use some cochlear inspired methods where we have neurons that react to certain frequencies. And we talk about both spatial information and spectral information that is processed in the human brain. We have adopted this, all adopted principles, and we also have some other principles of encoding information. For example, if there is a, like could be a pixel volume or could be a, another variable temperature, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 neurons associated to this input. I mean, could be, of course, could be a frequency. And the value of the intensity of this variable belonging to certain receptive field of neurons defines when this neuron will emit a spike. The higher the membership, the earlier the spike is generated, and this spike is further processed in the other areas of the brain, for example, the cortical area or the thalamus. If we have an input signal, it could be a pixel, could be a voice. There are different ways to encode this information over time as a continuous information to encode into spikes. And using different methods, we can achieve different accuracy of approximation of this signal into spikes. And if we recover it from the spike representation, we can see that different levels of recovery can be achieved. And the human brain has evolved its ways to encode this information in the best possible way. And that is why we survived over many years of evolution. And which methods to use? So we can see that for different input signals, there are continuous value signals, different methods would be more appropriate than, for example, band spike algorithm or step forward algorithm. Usually a step forward algorithm is based on a threshold for emitting the spike, which threshold can change over time based on the data. And there is a publication that that discusses this issue and suggests how to select your encoding method for your particular application. And I have left a copy of this PDF file of this presentation with the organizers. So if you're interested, you can contact them to get a copy of the PDF file of this presentation. And the spike encoding has several features, and they are good features. One is that it accesses data compression. Instead of dealing with scalars that may have 20 digits after the decimal point, we can deal with binary entities, spikes, but spikes at a certain time. So they are a very economical way to represent data and to process it. But also another feature is that any signals below the threshold of encoding are not encoded into spikes. So this is a noise suppression, small perturbation in the data cannot actually trigger a spike, which is a beautiful, beautiful technique to suppress noise. And we can see from this paper that using spiking representation, we can have a lot of compression of the data, and the accuracy is not compromised, of the accuracy of classification or prediction. Now, after encoding data into spike, or spike trains, I should say, or spike sequences over time, what do we do with these spike sequences? Well, we have spiking neurons that can learn from these spiking sequences to emit a spike or not to emit a spike at a certain time. So this pattern of spike sequences is transformed by this neuron in a sequence of spikes transferred to many other neurons. And this little neuron has actually memory because it won't spike immediately after the first spike coming. It holds, it increases the membrane potential until the membrane potential comes to a certain threshold and this neuron spikes. And then again, membrane potential goes to the stable level and again. And that is how this neuron has a little memory and also reacting in time. So there are different types of spiking neurons generated so far or introduced in the literature so far, starting from Hodgkin, Huxley, spike response, integrated. This is an integrated fire neuron that has been very popular and very straightforward to realize as an electrical circuit. So it is based on a capacitor that acts as a membrane, accumulating the information, and the resistor that acts as the connection weight here. That is changing its value. And having spiking neurons, in a spiking neural network, they are connected between each other, and we call one neuron connected to another neuron. It is a directed connection from output here goes to the input to this neuron, and the connection weight changes over time through learning, and that is what we do all the time. We learn through changing connection weights, and the connection weights change here, not only in terms of inputs here, but in terms of spikes emitted in the presynaptic and the so-called postsynaptic neuron. If the spike of postsynaptic neuron comes after the spike of presynaptic within certain time, the connection weight increases, and it depends on the window of time that is used to measure this synchronization. So otherwise the connection weight decreases. So these two neurons, spiking neurons, they learn temporal association between them. And that is the significant departure from traditional neural networks or traditional systems. Time is learned in the connections of the systems. Time matters here, and it is learned as association and probably as a causality between the neurons and between areas of neurons in the brain. So we can actually use this principle to build spatial-temporal systems in a better way. And we can have different rules along with the spike time dependent plasticity rule, as I showed. We can introduce the direction of the signals. If we have this information, and if this is the direction from the presynaptic, postsynaptic neurons to, we increase the connection weight to the postsynaptic neuron in a higher way, because this postsynaptic neuron is closer to the direction. So we can introduce different types of information, and that becomes a vehicle for building multimodal information processing systems, space, spatial distribution, time, and direction is introduced, integrated together as suggested in this paper here. Now, spike time dependent plasticity was unsupervised, but what about supervised learning when we have a certain pattern and we want this neuron? If this neuron is presented with this pattern, this neuron, we want this neuron to spike, to recognize this pattern as an object as my face, as a cup. Of course, it is not one neuron, that is many, many neurons used. We can use the so-called supervised learning methods to train the connection weights of this neuron to spike when a particular pattern in space, in time, comes to this neuron. And one way is called rencoder learning, where the order of the incoming spikes matters. And the earlier the spike comes in a synapsis or dendrite, the higher the connection weight is increasing. And we can also have a threshold of this neuron to spike a little bit lower than the maximum pattern presented. So we can make this neuron to spike early. And that is why I can predict some moving objects to me, or we can build predictive systems that can predict the whole pattern, even the pattern is not presented as a whole pattern, but only part of it. And we can make these predictive systems to predict weather, to predict Alzheimer. That is what we use in applications. Using this principle of predictive spiking of neurons through learning. And there are some neurons that can not only predict one spike, but when we have a certain patterns of inputs, and remember that the neuron in the brain has 20,000 inputs to it, dendrites, we can make this neuron to emit a sequence of spikes at a desired time, not only one. But when we present this pattern, this neuron will emit this spike. How do we do that? Well, there is one system which is called SPAN, published already and available, that can make this neuron to be trained and the connection weight change so that when this pattern is presented to this neuron, the neuron emits a series of spikes, one after another. So we can make the, if the robot recognizes certain situation changing over time, the robot emits reacts in a smooth way. And this is the so-called delta rule used with some kernels that are approximating spikes. So if this is the desired spike here, and if we have many spikes for this pattern, and we have what it actually has generated, we can apply the error and we can change the connection weights accordingly. So this is the error of changing the connection weights so that eventually this neuron will emit the desired spike or the desired sequence of spikes over time. And using these principles of spike time dependent plasticity, spiking neurons, learning rules, we can build spike neural networks, spiking neural networks, and in different structures. We can build feed forward structures, we can build recurrent structures, we can build coalition, and that is all happening in the brain. We have many structures, and they are not fixed. They evolve through learning from data to do some classification or regression or prediction. Different structures are possible to build. And these structures could include thousands of spiking neurons, even millions of spiking neurons. And the spiking neural networks have already started being used to do some, segmentation of images. You can see this paper. It's called spike segmentation via spike time dependent plasticity. Also, some deep spiking neural networks, deep structures of feed forward spiking neural networks have been developed. For example, to recognize CT images and classify them into COVID or normal. And these deep spiking neural networks have been wonderful to recognize image, but as I said, they are excellent, this feed forward, excellent for vector frame-based data image, but not for spatial temporal or temporal data and for knowledge extraction. They have fixed structures and not flexible for adaptive learning. What do we do? Well, let's actually try to build more flexible systems, more brain-like systems that are not fixed in number of layers, a number of connections, a number of neurons in each layer. How do we do that? And this is one approach. We call it brain-inspired spiky neural networks. Brain-inspired spiky neural networks means in this case that we use a brain template. And in brain template, every areas of the brain has a certain three-dimensional coordinates, X, Y, Z. If we have a neuron here to represent these coordinates, so we can build a three-dimensional spiky neural network that is structurally designed to represent a brain template. And we can train such system with spike sequences after encoding this input information. And we can use the spike time dependent plasticity or other learning rules, and we can have classifiers to classify these patterns here and to activate some actions like moving the hand of a robot or giving the signal of a particular event. One of the systems, brain-inspired spiky neural network system developed so far, and it was developed in my group, and we are knows about that, I'm sure, when he visited my lab, is called NewCube. And NewCube is structured according to a brain template. It learns from input data, and the input data is mapped into certain areas, spatially located areas of the cube, depending on the spatial location of the input sources. For example, if we talk about brain data, we have EEG or fMRI spatially located sources. We can map them here exactly in spatial locations of these spiky neurons. We can also include genetic information if we have such to help learn this cube, and we can classify in a classification system the output of this cube. And here is how it works. It works like having input spike inputs to certain input spiking neurons here. And the system, the tube, creates connections based on spike time dependent plasticity or rather temporal learning rule over time. And it actually creates clusters of such connections over time that reflect that activity measured in the input data. And this pattern of activity can be classified in a classifier. Some of the classifiers can be based on spiky neural networks. Other classifiers can be used classical classifiers like support vector machine or some multilayer perceptron, et cetera. But I will actually talk about classifier that using spiky neurons. And the classifier produces some outputs, and these outputs can be used to improve the system or to learn further. And here is one video that shows how this tube that is brain designed to brain template, how it learns from input data, and the input data is spikes. Every spike generates possibly an increased in connections or decreased in connections if two neuron spikes at different times. And this is no more a black box. It is a system that we can observe over time, how it works, what it does, what areas are more connected than other areas. That actually informs us about the data and the problem that this data is measuring. So we can zoom at the connections, and we can zoom at the neurons, what they do over time. And that is the main advantage of this approach, as I said, for spatial, spectral, temporal data modeling. And such structure can be understood, can be visualized in terms of what clusters are created, what is the activities, dynamic activity between the input variables, and thicker the line in a graph, the more exchange of information happens between these two clusters. So that gives us a lot of information. As I said, we can extract some knowledge. We can represent this knowledge, if you like, in terms of rules and fuzzy rules, and that is some of my students have been doing so far. Now, in terms of classifiers, one of the approaches to build the so-called evolving classifiers, where we have output neurons evolving to capture new input data. And one of the evolving classifiers called dynamic evolving classifier that sets the first connections to the neurons based on the first bytes, but then it changes, updates the connection weights based on other incoming spikes. And this is a topic in one book, which is called Evolving Connection Systems, that I published in Springer. Now, having all these principles already discussed and all these approaches, how do we design a particular system for particular applications? Well, we have to go through different stages to analyze the data, to design the reservoir or the tube, to encode the data, to map the input variables, to apply unsupervised, supervised learning classification, to optimize parameters, to visualize it, to extract rules, to implement this model. And one environment that we have developed for building spiky neural network systems using NeuQube is shown here, and it uses some optionally some hardware accelerator like the Spinnaker system that actually can run 100,000 spiky neurons in parallel, producing results every millisecond. And this is also realized in different languages available for people to download. And we can implement such system in different ways. We can use this so-called traditional ways means that we can have the von Neumann computer, Atanasoff von Neumann, Atanasoff computer, or we can have neuromorphic systems developed starting with Carver Mead from Caltech, and we have Spinnaker by Steve Fulber, and we have chips, Giacomo Individuo, we have silicon dynamic vision sensor by Toby Delbrook, or FPGA realizations by Martin Magnetti, and many other laboratories in the world. We have also some self-repair architectures developed in the Intelligent System Research Center in Ulster University. Now, applications are many applications going from brain data to audio-visual data to bioneuroinformatics, multisensory streaming data, and I cannot cover all of them. I will just go through some examples of applications. And for each of these applications that we have developed, we have used the same design steps. And they are more presented in this book, Time Space, Spiky Neural Networks and Brain Inspired Artificial Intelligence. Talking about neuroimaging data, we can actually see the application of such systems for EEG data, for fMRI data. When they are encoded into spikes, and then the system is trained, and it is classified, and it is analyzed. How do we map data, EEG data? We have the EEG channels, for example. EEG channels are located in the three-dimensional cortical areas, and we can have neurons representing each of these channels as input neurons to the cube. So when we enter the temporal data, this cube will learn association between these channels, between these areas, between these clusters. And many applications of EEG data, for example, emotion recognition from facial expression, or learning the dynamics of the brain activities. For example, here is brain activities when people are looking at a familiar object, even at 200 milliseconds. There are quite a lot of temporal activity, spatial temporal activity in the brain. And if they are looking at unfamiliar object, nothing doesn't ring a bell, we can see that very little activities happen in this. And we can also measure the difference between, let's say, mild cognitive impairment of people. And after 6 months, some of these people develop Alzheimer's disease. We can see that mapping their signals into the tube, the new tube, doesn't actually show much activities. And all these are experiments and publications that are available now. And fMRI data, functional magnetic resonance images that cover the whole volume of the brain, can also be mapped into the tube and classified. And if we use the new tube classifier to classify, for example, data of people who are looking at images or hearing voices, I think the classification of new tube is much better than other techniques. But integrating fMRI EEG data is not easy, and we are looking at some new methods for integrating it, because fMRI data are in different temporal and spatial scales. They are very precise in terms of the spatial, but not very precise in time, and the EEG data are vice versa. We can use also MRI data, magnetic resonance images over time, over 6 years, to predict whether certain person will develop Alzheimer's disease, dementia or not. And the classification and the predictions, 2-year prediction of Alzheimer's disease or dementia, using these data it becomes accurate. And even 4 years prediction is also good accuracy. So using MRI data measured over time, these are images, two-dimensional images measured over time, making a so-called longitudinal data, can give us a good understanding of how dementia develops in certain groups of people, and to even predict who is going to develop that or not. Talking about the visual streaming data, a usual approach is take a camera and take frame by frame this video and recognize frame by frame the data. But another way is to transfer this video into sequence of spikes. And these spikes are asynchronous transfer of every pixel into series of spikes or every area. It's not frame by frame, but it is spike-based, asynchronous data analysis and image analysis, which could be much faster than waiting for the frame and processing the whole frame. And some applications like surveillance and cybersecurity, military application, autonomous vehicles will benefit of using encoding in dynamic information, moving object into spikes and classifying this. And even a small spike in activity can trigger a class output rather than waiting for the whole frame. Now, talking about integrating audio and visual information, we have auditory visual information. We can build spiking modules, spiking neural network modules for each of these and combine them. And here we have the combination between the auditory, say, a word and the image, the face, combined into person authentication recognition. And that gives much better accuracy when we are using only auditory or only visual information to recognize a person or intruder. And all these applications are published in papers, so you can have a look if you're interested in these papers further. Recognizing music using cochleograms of representation, and the brain-like template used for the spiking neural network allows us to have a stereo music recognized or stereo input recognized in the left cochleogram and the right cochleogram, and we can see that such approach can very efficiently recognize music by Mozart, Bach, and Vivaldi, much better than the human recognition. I'm not sure that you can hear that different, very short segments of music. And if we train the system, we can see that connectivity is different for Mozart, for Bach and Vivaldi. And that is reflecting on the type of the signal, the spectral, temporal features of the signal. Using such approach for brain-computer interfaces, when we can record thoughts or brain signals into a new tube, and we activate the output of the new tube to control a robot, is also a new way to build brain-computer interfaces, or to understand how the humans relate to virtual reality. How do they learn? How do they recover from stroke? We can also use multisensory information, which is spatial-temporal information, to build spiky neural networks to recognize certain events. For example, in this particular case, it's an event of stroke, a human individual stroke, or event like earthquake, because we have spatially distributed sensors or stations, they collect temporal data. And if we map this spatial temporal data into new tube, we can see that we can get much better prediction of earthquake in Christchurch based on historical data than using other methods that use frame-based representation. Or looking at wind farms and wind energy, which is very modern in terms of the pollution of the area. And I think this is what is a hot topic now in Glasgow during the summit 26. Using the spatial-temporal information from each of these stations can give us a better prediction of the power, electricity generated by this farm. And this is New Zealand, and this is Xinjiang in China. Predicting floods based on multi-sensory information is a project that was done in Malaysia. And we can see that the prediction 1 day or 3 days ahead using a spiky neural network is much better than using multilayer perceptron or regression techniques. And this is very important in some areas. It's again multi-sensory spatial temporal information. Predicting pollution in London is another paper that was based on spiky neural networks, but we have ensembles of spiky neural networks. Each ensemble, each module reflects on particular distribution of the input data. And if we cluster the spatial temporal data, we can see that in maybe cold time, this one is better than the hot weather, and this one is in the middle weather. I think that their overall prediction is much better as an ensemble of spiking neural networks. Or predicting pollution in Beijing and in Shanghai. This is also what was done by a group in China. Yeah, as a conclusion, I would say that the advantages of brain-inspired spiking neural networks are several. We talk about self-organization, event-based asynchronous representation, temporal, or spatial spectral temporal association. They are interpretable, low computational power when implemented in a neuromorphic hardware. They have a very high fault tolerance. Of course, there are some problems like sensitive to parameter values, large number of parameters, no rigid theory yet. And we can look at the difference between the statistical classical methods, the second generation of neural networks and spiky neural networks, in terms of information representation and other features that we can look at. The future is, according to some projects, is in interaction, in human-like interaction between machines and humans through knowledge transfer from humans to machines. So we make the machines to act like humans. That is one future direction. And we talk about inspiration from biology, from neuroinformatics, from bioinformatics, from mathematics, to build new type of data technologies, more transparent artificial intelligence. Of course, there are quite a lot of problems, and some of the problems are ethical problems. You can go to one of the blogs, which is called mindthegap.ai, and see that there are many blogs that comment on the ethical problems of such systems in the future. And I should say that the world community of brain-inspired spiky neural networks and brain-inspired artificial intelligence is growing. We have here about 30 countries that are using these techniques in YouTube and other spiky neural networks techniques, and this number is growing. And I'm happy to take questions and try to answer them. I should say that again, thank you very much indeed for inviting me for this lecture at the Rochester Institute of Technology. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kasabu. It's really, wow, a very comprehensive talk, including cognition, including using of generating spikes, including many other applications, so like something like I never can imagine, air pollution and energy, geography, those kind of things, and including some typical applications in image and audio and sound, those kind of things. I myself has quite a lot of questions, but I would first prefer to have the audience to ask questions. And actually there is someone who is want to ask question, Alex Arabia, well, you can either speak out or type in whatever you prefer.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, Alex.
Yeah. So I've actually done some work on spike trains and spiking neural networks. And so I've a couple of questions. I'll try to see if I can phrase them very quickly. I'll break them down into pieces. So the first one is that you talked about the learning mechanism. So I work in learning algorithms in trying to find alternatives to backpropagation of errors in general, because backprop is clearly not what's going on in the brain. I would think you probably would agree with something like that. And I glanced at a couple of your papers, and I think you said it in your talk. So it looks like NeoCube is learned with evolutionary type approach. So have you looked at, because I know STDP, spike time dependent plasticity, is kind of like the go-to algorithm for, like, let's say biomodeling, but it isn't very good for scaling up to the big tasks that you talk about, at least not to my knowledge. So is that particularly why you went into neuroevolution, and have you been considering other alternatives to perhaps learn locally? Because evolution is clearly happening, but like at a global scale over a species over time, whereas our brains are learning dynamically right now, not likely, at least from my perspective, with a genetic algorithm. So do you have a comment on that? I'll stop because I have two more little questions, but yes. I want to hear your thoughts on that.
The answer is we call them evolving systems because they evolve their connectivity and the output neurons evolve through learning, but they are not evolutionary over time. They are not population generation based. Indeed, the brain, our systems learn locally through making local connections and presenting a global trajectory, a global activity when the system is working. You're absolutely right. It's a dynamic learning. It's a STDP, but it is not only STDP. This is one example. We, in my group, we have developed different methods, as I said, SPAN and other orientation informed STDP. This is only the tip of the iceberg. And if you're working in this area, I think you're on the right track. We would like to see new learning algorithms that are more efficient for different applications, because there is no one algorithm that can actually do all the jobs. We need to improve that all the time, inspired by biology and by neuroscience. Thank you, Alex.
Yeah, and it's likely probably more than one algorithm in tandem. Combination of algorithms is probably what's going on in actual neurons.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So my other next question, and this is kind of related to the field of machine learning in trying to, because, you know, spiky neural nets are often called the third generation of neural nets. But deep learning is, you know, quite a far cry from that. It's point-wise neurons that are not stateful in most problems, especially in like classification. So at what level of biological fidelity do you think we need to go? Because you talked about Hodge and Huxley, there's Eshkovitz. I work with leaky integrate and fire neurons because they're like a compromise between ReLU activities and, you know, the very complicated that you need a supercomputer to simulate Hodge and Huxley. At what level do you think that you would want to argue we do need to go and to convince, for example, the rest of the field that we could still scale up? Do you think that we're missing something in leaky integrate and fire neurons that we can't generalize on certain tasks? Or do you think everything could be done with a very, very simple approximation that we don't need to model the full biological detail? Because neurons are, like you said, complicated creatures and they even have their own memory, but you know, we also have the problem of computational simulation. And so as we try to build more realistic neurons, while we do get hardware efficiency, and that is a huge thing, generalization to even tasks like reinforcement learning is challenging. So at what level do you think that, for example, leaky integrate and fire is not even sufficient? We do need to go to Eshkovitz. I don't know what you think is the right level for the machine learning field to start to say, well, yes, to scale and to do things we can't do, we need these types of neurons.
Yes, absolutely. That's a good question. And let me say that the brain as inspiration has so many principles. We don't have to use all complex models for solving different tasks. For example, if we want to classify fMRI data or EEG data, we don't need to have a very complicated neuron. We can see that even with the spike time dependent plasticity learning rule and integrate and fire, we can classify perfectly fMRI data and we can understand the functional connectivity between that without going for biologically plausible neurons like Sienkiewicz, Moore, or Hodgkin-Huxley. So it depends on the task. What do we want to do? If we want to recognize images, we don't need the biologically plausible. We need a more engineering approach to make this system work on spatial spectrotemporal data, classify images, predict events. I think it depends on the application, and there are huge variety of options that we can choose from. I'm working on brain-computer interfaces for very close brain data, very precise brain data analysis. I need something more to develop and still using the brain as inspiration, more sophisticated than the integrated and fine neuron. But for classifying sensory images, for example, earthquake prediction, I don't need that. I need some more engineering approach. So your question is absolutely right. There is no one way to solve all problems. The brain is a huge inspiration of diversity of methods that we can implement in different machines.
And then my last tiny question, then I'm done. So the biggest problem, and I'm a biologically inspired machine learning researcher, the time I often face with reviewers in the community is convincing them the reasons why we should go to something more biologically realistic instead of good old-fashioned backprop and, you know, deep learning. Because recently I've been working in reinforcement learning and temporal problems. And I would argue that these are the hardest places to demonstrate why we want to move into something biorealistic. And you probably feel this way. I was curious to know your difficulties and the ways you convinced reviewers. For example, if you're doing something like reinforcement learning, we're processing many steps in time and spiking neural nets. And I work in predictive coding, predictive processing. We have, you and I have the problem of we have to process an input at every discrete step in time in a stimulus window, right? Because the spiking neural network, right, needs to see even a single image. It needs to see it over a period of like 100 milliseconds or 500 milliseconds at a certain frequency, even if we're using Poisson spike trains to simulate the input, in order for the neurons to build a threshold and fire. So ultimately, if we're simulating them on a von Neumann architecture, like a classic computer, reviewers will never, just even machine learning researchers will never buy. They'll say backprop's always going to be faster because, you know, we can just instantly do one forward pass and we're done. We have our prediction, whereas you and I have to process over a long window. And then, of course, if we get into RL, do you think that the stimulus window, is it just a matter of saying like, well, okay, we just have the wrong computers. We need neuromorphic hardware to become democratized because otherwise you and I can't take advantage of the sparsity in a spiking network on a standard simulated computer. So I was wondering your difficulties in convincing the community, or do you stay largely in the biological cognitive community? Because it seems like machine learning is rather adversarial to the biological alternatives to backprop. When they say backprop works well enough, it's always going to be faster than a spiking neural network, no matter what. Whereas we have to work over stimulus windows and they do not. So I was curious to know your thoughts. And that's my last question.
Yeah, let me say that what we want to move is move from a fixed structure. Even the recurrent neural networks, they have fixed recurrent connections. We don't want that to happen. What we want is more self-organized, more driven by data systems. So they create recurrent connections if necessary within this structure through local learning. And you can see that globally, there are quite a lot of recurrent connections, but they are self-organized. They are organized from the data. And whether we use one approach or another, I think that's a matter of decision. I'm actually arguing for the brain-like, more self-organized way based on spatial-temporal patterns they are captured from the data. So I think different approaches are possible. This is one approach with the brain-like self-organized approach where recurrent connections are built internally as needed. And what is the window of data that we use? That is also flexible, that the brain can actually deal with that. If there is a pattern recorded in a certain window without fixing that in the time, space, or frequency time domain, the brain will react to that. So I'm arguing for more flexibility in the development of the machines rather than rigidness. Thank you, Alex.
Thank you.
Other question? Yavin, you can directly speak.
Hi, Professor Nicola. I have a question. So because we know that the extracted spice will also is usually sparse and discontinuously. So how, in your experience, how do you efficiently optimize them to be, to prevent the network from suddenly going to the crashing or something?
Yeah, let me say that parameter optimization is a big problem. And we know that in spiking neural networks, even small change in parameters can lead to change in the whole behavior of the system. And we use some different methods to optimize parameters and to optimize the connectivity, actually. Homeostasis is one approach that is more biological, more brain. The brain never overheats and then always keeps kind of cool to make a decision. We can also use some other techniques like fast evolutionary computation to initially optimize some parameters, etc. And looking at the brain, the brain parameters are the genes, and the genes have been optimized over evolution of millions of years. And we don't have this time to optimize the parameters of the spiking neural networks, but we can compress the optimization process to some techniques. And indeed, this is an open question, and everybody is invited to join this problem of parameter optimization in spiking neural networks. Thank you.
Thanks. I have other small questions. So from the, I glanced at your developed neural cube software. I saw there is some methods to mapping the EEG signals to the extracted specs, but I didn't find a method to extract the image or videos to the specs because that's from your GitHub and your software. And I only found an explanation to tell us how to convert the EEG signals to the real spikes.
Yeah, so I think the software we have developed is only one implementation. Yeah. I would have the student implementation available in compiled MATLAB code, or we have also Python, we have Java code open source. And if you're interested, you can download these versions. Along with them, we have some demo data, and you can see how the mapping and the structure of the tube is designed according to Thaler-Arch template. So every neuron has a coordinate that corresponds to the Thaler-Arch template. And if we map the EEG signals, we also use the so-called 1020 system or 1010 system. Every channel of the EEG has a three-dimensional coordinate that actually corresponds to a neuron in this template. So that is how we map the data. But you can also learn through some running some of the demo data, and you can understand that. Otherwise, you can contact us for help.
Okay, got you. Yeah, thanks.
Some other questions? So actually, time is not quite a lot, but I want to ask a question because I'm from image science and we work out quite a lot on imaging things. And for images, and if we want to use spiking neural network, do you think we should focus more right now on how to more efficiently or correctly converting an image to spikes, or focusing on more later part after generating the spikes, we develop some other classifier or regressors to precise those kind of specs? What do you think we should focus more or focus both?
You can use spiking neural networks directly on dynamic visual information like videos, and it will be directly transformed into spikes using some spiking encoding methods like a threshold based or brain spike. If you talk about static images, for example, recognizing faces from a photo, then you can still use spiking neural networks because the different brightness of the pixels is transformed into, as a spectral scale, it is transformed into spikes based on the brightness. The brighter the spot, the first spike is generated. And you can encode your static image into a sequence of spikes over time, actually, that can be processed further to recognize this image in a spiking neural network. So even static images are spectro-temporal. It depends how you see that. So they are, and I showed one example of classifying COVID CT scan versus normal, and it's a static image that is transformed into spike sequences, and then deep neural network, deep spiking neural network is used for that. So it is an open area for the future.
Right. Thank you. So I think for videos, that would be even better, has better effect, I would say.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, great. Some other questions from the audience? If no, we will end up here. Let's then, any other questions first? So, then let's thank to Dr. Kasabu another time, and it's really great talk, and we really learned quite a lot of basic things and more deeper things about spiking neural network and the different applications. I think this is good start and a good introductory for many of others who know or who just don't know about spiking neural network. Thank you very much, Dr. Kasabu.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the questions. I hope that we will keep in touch in the future. All the
Absolutely.
Best.
By the way, for all the audience, I have a copy of Dr. Kasabu's talk. And if you want to know more about, if you forgot something, and later we will post the talk into YouTube. And if you forgot something out, if you want to refer something, you can go to the YouTube. Or if you want a copy of Dr. Kasabu's talk, you can send me a message. So you can search my name in Google, and with RIT, you can search, find how to contact me, and I can send you a copy of Dr. Kasabu's talk. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Kasabu.
All the best. Bye-bye.
All the best. See you.
All the best. Thank you. Thank you very much.